kids have been retarded. I've gotten emails from people that are retarded. And they're like, I don't know, it's kind of awesome. You know?
Is it Philadelphia?
Mm-hmm. It's in Philadelphia.
At where?
Art and Theater.
Art and Theater.
And so
drinks and sit down a little
bit.
So in between, and I'm really glad that everybody's having a chance to chat. Chat up the locals. So that you can get a better sense of what is going on in Arizona and take advantage of their stories and their knowledges. I think one of the things that sort of I reflected upon just recently about this last panel, that in a funny kind of way, it's also a story about small monies. What can a community do that doesn't have a whole lot of deep pockets? And what can you produce? And what does that mean for the producer and presenter who works in the inside the sphere of small monies? I remember years ago in Houston, taking a cab, going to diverse works of presenter, downtown was very quiet. And I said, what's going on? And he says, big money lays people off. Small monies keeps downtowns alive. So, in a funny kind of way, small monies keep our locales alive. I share that story to sort of create an entrance into this discussion today among producers and presenters. We have a group of panelists that come from very diverse backgrounds. Allie Haynes Hemlin, did I say that right? Is from the Scottsdale Center. Gabriel Munoz is from the Arizona Commission of the Arts, and Tim Wilson is from the Western Arts Alliance. So I'm going to let them talk a little bit and introduce themselves a little bit about their work vis-a-vis a question. And you can take as long as you want or as little time as you want around this notion of what are the access points that you are engaged in for artists and new work development. And what are the challenges associated with that? So who wants to go first? Tim, I'm going to give it to you.
All right. First of all, I'll just say a little bit about Western Arts. Is this working? Hello?
Fair enough.
It's about
power up. He must be dead.
Go here, take this one.
So Western Arts Alliance is a regional performing arts organization, a market that serves the Western states and Canada. We were established in 1967, and we serve about 400 organizations, principally in the Western United States. We operate essentially as a market. So we have an annual conference where we convene artists, individual artists, producing companies, artist managers that represent other artists, and then performing arts centers from around the West. And WAW was established in 1967 by a group of universities. And so universities are kind of the backbone, those big universities are sort of the backbone of our network. So I'm going to be speaking from that perspective. I've never lived in Arizona or in Tucson, although I once was diagnosed with dysentery at the University Hospital and spent some time there. But I'm really going to speak from a regional perspective. And first of all, I want to say give a shout out to Kita and the National Theater Project and New England Foundation for the Arts for facilitating this conversation. It's really a privilege just to be in the room with you to listen to the conversation. It's really been an amazing conversation to hear. I think speaking directly to Roberto's question about access, it's really, really difficult on a regional level, and to say nothing of the sort of the local level. And we're working on a couple points right now that are, I think, of relevance. Actually, three points. One, we're working with cultivating new young arts leaders. We used to have a program called, I'm really annoyed by this microphone. Can I speak without it? Can you hear me without it?
It's difficult.
Okay, all right. So just the feedback is bothering me. We have a program called 35 Below. We used to have a program called Next Gen for the next generation of arts leaders, and we didn't find that that was actually specific enough. So it's now 35 Below, where we're cultivating sort of a new cadre of arts professionals, artists, artist managers, people in the presenting field who are young and bringing new ideas to the field. Because to me, there's nothing more exciting than that leadership. Because the field, and I myself included, was really dominated in leadership positions by baby boomers. And those baby boomers are on the verge of retirement, and there's about to be a sea change in leadership. And so we're working to cultivate that. So young leaders and artists, and we have a network, and they some of it's social, some of it's just getting to know one another, some of it's sharing experience with one another, some of it's learning, some of it's introducing them to other leaders where they can sort of start to get to know other senior leaders in the field. And so that's been going and been very successful. Another point of access that we are working on, and I can speak about the challenges of that after I get done introducing them all. Another point of access that we're working on is around Latino artists and audiences. So we're working, we have a sort of a nascent program now that's about 2 years old, and we're again trying to cultivate Latino artists, arts professionals, around sort of how to work in this performing arts. So among these sort of major players, the bigger players and the university presenters that we represent. And then the third thing is this is a new project that we've undertaken just in the last year or so. We're working with colleagues in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, and the United States to work on how we work collectively in our networks to advance Indigenous performance. Because there is just, I mean, it's hardly out there at all. And so we did a session in Vancouver, Kita was there, and it was a first step for us. And largely, it was almost a meeting like this, where the most important thing for us was to have people in the room to begin a conversation, to sort of get to know one another, to learn about protocols, and just to have some initial conversations. And we had a capacity for like 95, and we sold it out. And it was kind of astonishing to me that there was that much interest in this topic. But there was. 40% of the participants were from Indigenous communities. So it wasn't just sort of white people getting together to talk about how can we advance Indigenous performance. But we worked really closely with Full Circle, which is an Indigenous producer in Vancouver, with IPA, with other, IPA is the Indigenous Performing Arts Alliance, which is a really amazing organization in Canada, if you don't know it. And then with the Aboriginal programs at the Canada Council and the Australia Council and Creative New Zealand to put this program together. And it was a really rich conversation for us, and so successful for our steering committee that we're actually continuing to convene the group that put this program together. And I will have to say, just to make it clear, I did not put this program together. We hosted it, essentially, and we drew on 13 arts professionals, Indigenous arts professionals. Some of them were performers, some of them were producers, some of them were presenters, some of them were arts administrators in public programs. We convened this group of 13. They met entirely by conference call and put the full program together. They set the agenda, they set the programs, they set the speakers, they put it all together. And this was really, I sort of like, well, of course, that's how you do this, but it was really a game changer for Wong. Because typically what we do is we identify a topic and then we look for the authorities within our community or within sort of an arm's reach of our community, and then and we put them together, we put a panel together. This was the backwards, the reverse of that, where we started from with folks that we, essentially most of whom, we had no relationship with whatsoever. But we relied on kind of elders or tradition bearers to sort of point us in the right direction to propose this group. So that has been it's a small effort. We don't have a big budget. It's very modest, as with most of the things we do at Western Arts Alliance. But it's been a big step forward for us, and we continue the challenges. Well, let's see. Money, colonialization, racism, ignorance. Ignorance is, I think, for presenters, is one of the biggest obstacles. Because there's even, and I think you've sort of touched on it in some of the points that have been made, is that even when they're well-intentioned, they really feel that this is something that's important, that they need to do, they're held back by their own lack of understanding. So the fear of making a mistake or saying something that's insulting or inappropriate holds many presenters, artists, and managers back from taking even the first step. So conversations like this, where you can begin to build understanding, I think are really important. The last, I think those are the three things I wanted to say, and I don't want to go on a length, but I'm going to come back to funding and other points of access and how you gain access to this, but I'm going to go share mine.
I'm Allie Hamlet. I'm the director at Scottsdale Center for the Performing Arts. I'm also honored to be the president of the board of directors for the Arizona Presenters Alliance. So I'm going to try to speak to some access points at both my Performing Arts Center and some others in the greater Phoenix area. Sorry, Tucson people, I'm not as well versed in Tucson as I am in Phoenix, obviously. But I will say, as far as access points at the Scottsdale Center for the Performing Arts, we've, over the past 2 years, worked really hard to create programs that engage local artists in performing on our stage. We do a lot of festival programming, a lot of free programming out on our outdoor stages throughout the spring season. And what we found, more often than not, was a lot of the bands and the artists and the spoken word artists that we work with didn't have a lot of experience in a hard ticket venue, which is like, we know what our venue is, see the venue, but not just at a bar or at a festival atmosphere. These bands wanted experience in an actual venue with selling tickets and being more of that realm where they can start to build that experience and start touring. So we created a summertime program called Live and Local, where we engaged a lot of the bands that we had for our festival programming and for our free outdoor events. And we booked them on a stage every Friday in the summertime. We had a very low ticket price, $10, and we split the ticket with the artist we got from ticket number one. So they didn't have to worry about our expenses. We didn't have to worry about their needs. It was very much a very mutual relationship, and it has taken off. We're just about to launch our third season with that, and we're really excited about it. We're talking about expanding the program into a holiday version to continue this program throughout the holidays. And we're also now starting to investigate doing a much smaller scale program in our small theater, which seats 137, that's more of a cabaret style, that's really geared towards more towards experimental artists and folks that maybe don't have a wide reach of followers already, that can try out new work and have a small audience of 100 people so that they can really nurture what they're doing, but still have that opportunity to work with our professional crew, our professional staff, our marketing team, all of the resources that we can bring to that table. They will benefit from that. And of course, we benefit from that as well, because a lot of these artists we know, because artists in Arizona are pretty amazing, are gonna move on into a larger realm, and they're gonna tour all over the country, and they're going to be known throughout the region and throughout the country, and so we're excited to be part of the ground floor of that. So those are some of the access points that we have at the center. I can also talk about the Mesa Arts Center has a really robust relationship with Jazz at Lincoln Center. They have been partnering with Jazz at Lincoln Center for the past 6 or 7 years, I would say. They are fully incorporating jazz into their curriculum throughout the Mesa Public Arts Schools. And I'm sorry, public art. I'm sorry. Scottsdale Public Art is one of my sister divisions, and I'm a little, I tend to go to that, sorry. Throughout the Mesa Public School District, is what I'm trying to say. So they have incorporated jazz throughout the Mesa Public School District curriculum, and now they're working with Jazz at Lincoln Center program, where they actually have an arts leadership training program that's centered on jazz principles to train the new generation of arts leaders. So I know they're getting ready to launch that, and they're looking to engage folks who are interested in administration, artists, artist managers, that sort of thing. So that is another big access point that I know Mesa Arts Center is really working hard to foster. And the last one that I wanted to talk about was at the Del Webb Performing Arts Center in Wickenburg, Arizona, which is another really small community northwest of the greater Phoenix area. And they have a dance residency program that they have been running for the past 3 or 4 years, where they'll engage a dance company to come in. The dance company doesn't have to pay anything to be there. They provide a week, 2 weeks sometimes, of housing, tech support, facility use, staff, everything. And the only thing that they ask of this dance company is that they allow some of their rehearsals to be open so that audiences can just come and watch them rehearse. They don't participate. They're not allowed to speak to the dancers. They're not allowed to intrude. They just are able to watch. And then at the end of the residency, the company will perform a free performance at the Del Webb Performing Arts Center of whatever they've created during that residency. It's half an hour of work, it's 45 minutes of work. Some dance companies have used it to refine a full-length work that they want to get ready to put out into the world to tour, and so it'll be a full-length program that's offered for free to the residents of Wickenburg to come check out. So these are just a few examples of some of the access points that I know some of the bigger performing arts centers in the greater Phoenix area are making available to artists. And I know, coming to challenges, sorry about that. One of the biggest challenges is getting the word out about these programs and letting artists know that these programs exist and finding ways to make that communication known and finding ways to engage with artists that we may not realize we don't have access to, you know? And so that's, communication is definitely a huge, huge challenge for us. Another challenge that we have with a lot of these programs is staff capacity. Just like Mesa and Wickenburg, we're a really robust performing arts center. We've got a huge rentals program in addition to our presenting program. So summertime is usually a quiet time when the staff can do their maintenance, take their vacations. Well, now we've blown that out because we have this summer series that runs all summer long. So we do face an issue with staff capacity, especially when we're talking about creating new programs. So that's something on our end that we're working on, figuring out how we can access more funding to pay for that or engage with some of our local artists that might not be the performing artists on stage, but working behind the scenes so that they can also have that opportunity to work with the crew and at the same time kind of help offset some of those vacation times that we have to face. Another big challenge, of course, is with our marketing and our promotions department. Just same thing as staff capacity. You can only market so much, you can only promote so much. So that's a big part of how we've designed our program with the Live and Local and engaging with local artists. We do a door deal, so we split every ticket that's sold from $1 to really help engage the artists in promoting themselves as well. And this, for this third year that we're launching it, one of the biggest changes that we've done is to really create sort of a marketing and promotions tutorial for some of the artists that don't have a lot of experience doing that. Now that we have 2 years of this program, we've seen a lot of artists come through, and some that have been wildly successful, sold all 800 seats, and some that have been really not successful and only sold 150 seats. So we've tried to glean some of those best practices so that we can pass that along and kind of help teach artists the art of self-promotion, because that's a necessary evil, of course, in this business. I think that's all I've got.
Okay, hello, my name is Gabriela Munoz. I'm the newest addition to the Arizona Commission on the Arts. I'm very thankful to be invited to the conversation, but also just to really listen. I've learned a tremendous amount. So the commission is, we're a grant maker and we're a convener, and we offer professional development to all artists in the state of Arizona, which is a big task. Our funding is rather limited, I would say, but we do really try to work smarter because of that. And I would say that in terms of access points, So I am the arts programs manager. I'm supposed to be directing funding and support towards artists throughout Arizona, individual artists. So we offer professional development grants 3 times a year, and we offer artist research and development grants. We're also really fortunate. We received, my colleague Cassandra, who's now over at CALA, received funding from the Tremaine Foundation. So we have a program called ADR Worker. And I would say that the biggest resource we have is actually you. Being able to partner with different working artists, working groups, collectives, who are doing tremendous work in Arizona is what allowed us to then go to a funder and say, look at everything that's happening. Don't you want to help us support them? And really that's the reason why this funding came, right? So I would say that even though we have a deficit in terms of money, the work that you are all doing in your communities is invaluable. Challenges, money.
A couple of years ago, because we were looking at funding too from a regional perspective, so I'm a geek enough, and I know enough of the right people around, I did this big project where I went to the National Assembly of State Arts Agencies, which is the association of all the state arts agencies in the United States. And I asked for grant data on state grants, state arts grants, that were tagged or categorized for presenting or performing arts for all 50 states. Then I got the same data that NASA does collects data on grant making of the NEA itself on the NEA direct grants. And I got that same data for all NEA grants that were categorized under presenting or performing arts. And then I went to each of the regionals, or I got the same data from the regionals. And I compiled all of this, sort of state by state and region against region. And guess which region comes in dead last, and by not just a little, the West. The West is absolutely at the bottom of the heap in terms of public support at the state, the regional, and federal level. I mean, it is way at the bottom. And you know, I've heard people talk about sort of the coast and everything being better on the coast. Public funding in the Midwest is far, far better than it is on the West. Far better. There's no comparison. The only region that comes even close to is the South. And it's even better than the West. But for every other region of the country, public support is much, much stronger than what we have out here. So that is a huge, I mean, you can write all the grants in the world, Marcelino, and you can write all the grants in the world, but there just isn't as much in terms of public sector funding out here as there is in other parts of the country. So I think that's a really big issue. I also want to come back to a few things on access. And Allie and I were talking about on the break, and that is that we all tend to work in kind of our own little silos, in our own particular niche, our discipline interests, our community, with our people of our own age, or you know, or ethnicity, or economic level. We're all in these kind of silos together, and the silos really sort of keep us apart. And I think it's only by conversations like that where you can start to break down across region, across discipline, across economic status, all of these things to sort of begin to have some sort of sharing of information, because the sharing of information is a really a key part of access. I have other things. There's a couple of things going back to what's going on in terms of some positive notes, some positive ideas. And I think there's some models out there where there's really interesting things starting to happen and that are changing the way that we make work and show work in this country. Right now, our next conference is in Los Angeles in this August, and so I'm paying a lot of attention to what's going on in Los Angeles. And in LA right now, there's a really interesting phenomenon of individuals, arts professionals. I'm not going to call them artists, but they're individuals who are breaking down traditional roles. So that you have these people who are hybrid creator, producer, and presenters. that they're breaking, these things used to be separate functions, and now they're all happening in the same organization and by the same people. They're not relying on law or some other form or some presenter, UCLA, you know, the Center for the Arts Performance. They are finding their own way and playing these three roles all by themselves and with really modest budgets. There's a collective in Los Angeles called Echo Society, and they're a collective of designers. They do like set design and visual design and spatial design, and composers and musicians. And they are working and they're doing site-specific work, and they are turning over empty warehouses, derelict buildings into performance spaces on really modest budgets. And they are packing these venues with young hipsters to, I swear to God, their chamber music. It's contemporary chamber music, but it's chamber music. And it's really amazing kind of work. And I think there are models. In New York, there's a community of composers talking about, somebody made the point of, we need to support one another, and I couldn't agree more. There's a community of composers there who are composers and musicians. It formed around a fellow named Jet Greenstein at New Amsterdam. And these are young artists who compose, and then they play on each other's performances. They play on each other's albums. They work, I mean, it's this growing community, and it's really doing, they're doing some fascinating work, and it's beautiful work, and it's getting more and more recognition. And it's a community of players and composers who make these things happen. So I think there are models out there where we can see new hybrids and new ways of working. The other thing that I'll say too, and I don't know if this is as relevant to Arizona, but in LA in particular, this is happening elsewhere, there's also a dissolution of the commercial and the not-for-profit performance. In LA, you start to see choreographers and composers who work mostly in film and television crossing over and doing performance-based work. And these are choreographers who generally work with rock stars or on movies or on television shows, that are going over and creating these performance-based works. And the line is dissolving between the commercial and the not-for-profit in really interesting ways. So I think that there are opportunities out there, and there are some good points. Certainly access remains to be a very challenging issue and conversation.
And you
want to
piggyback on
it? Well, I guess I could just add, my own history. I moved to Arizona 12 years ago, specifically to work at the Center for the Performing Arts and for the woman who was director at that time, Kathy Oshner, some of you may know Kathy. But prior to that, I lived and worked in New York for a commercial theater producer, and we had sit-downs in all the major markets across the U.S., as well as touring nationally and internationally. So I had been on the road and in lots of different markets, producing this commercial projects that I grew to love. I had a theater degree, so I came into it with a very wary eye because I was not doing high art, I was doing commercial art, and that frustrated me. But then coming here to Scottsdale, my initial role was really to be a producer for a presenting organization, which was really, really challenging. And that was the main reason that Kathy brought me out to Arizona, to Scottsdale Center, because she said, we're leasing this theater, we're producing this show, we're presenters, we don't really have a grasp on what it is that we're trying to do. And so she brought me in to kind of help them get the show up off the ground. But I learned really quickly that to produce shows and present shows at the same time in one presenting organization is a huge challenge. I actually was fortunate to get some funding from California Presenters a few years ago to do an entire year study with the Broad Stage in Santa Monica, who is a performing arts center that has very much that model. They want to produce work as well as present work. And they had been working out this model and trying to study and figure out how they could do both. And this, I think, goes back to the challenges. And that's really where we kind of collectively came to the realization that staff capacity was tapped out. And you almost need two sets of parallel staff in order to do the producing end of things and the presenting end of things. So it's still very much a work in progress, but as we're doing at the center, and as I know they're doing at the Broad Stage, they continue to produce, we continue to produce, but really, and if somebody had talked earlier about the presenting arts organizations and the Gamages of the world who, you know, do these big flashy shows and make a lot of money, and we really do filter that money into the outreach programs and into the local artist programs that we do, because without it, you know, we wouldn't, without being able to present these, you know, big artists and the flashy commercial projects, we wouldn't be able to do these other programs that really are feeding our soul as a presenting, as an arts presenting organization. And so that was just the point I wanted to add on to Tim's comment about access and jobs.
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, you know, we are tasked with really trying to make a healthier, robust ecosystem. And I think that means, like, for me, specifically diversity and variety in terms of the size of organizations that we're supporting, the, you know, the support that we give to artists, you know, at multiple stages in their careers is a real challenge. We just did a professional development two-day training in Tucson, and that was like, we partnered with TCAC, and that was like, our biggest challenge was, you know, how do you, because it's not one size fits all. And the work that we do, you know, in Tucson is gonna be very different than the work we're about to do in Douglas, because the community is entirely different. And, you know, when we sit down with these partners that are doing the work on the ground, and we ask them, you know, what it is that they are looking for, right? What is it that you want? What is it that we think we're able to help with? And how do we then, like, make that happen? It looks really different in every little corner of, you know, Wickenburg is totally different than Douglas, than Nogales, than, I mean, it's a real challenge. And I think it's so important to listen to those partners. Like, that is a big challenge, I think, because it does require time, and our staff, you know, staff is limited.
Okay, here's the quick question. The trick question, not the quick question. In this role of presenter and producer, which you talked about, I guess the question is, how do you feed the curiosities of the artists you work with and the audiences that are out there that you're serving? So it's a question about curiosities and how they enter into the terrain of your work.
I guess I'll start quickly. So I'll go back a little bit to ACR Worker. It's a program that we're piloting in three cities, so Phoenix, Tucson, and Douglas. And what we're doing is we're bringing in artists to work within these three communities, artists and arts professionals, I should say. And the hope is that we get them to partner with our local counterparts, right? And that the dream is that they become co-creators of co-producers, and it's really tough. Like, it's really, really tough to do it right, and it's sort of a process, because what is the tendency is that the visiting artist comes in, right, and then takes over, and that's exactly what we are always vigilant upon, right? And it can be really hard, and I think, like, every different engagement has its own challenges. Just partnered with Mia for a program, Living Spirit. And we brought in a Santawa, right, Sumili, to do a workshop. And we had 25 people signed up, of performers. We had 35 people show up to the workshop. And so what that tells me is that there is a need and there is a desire, right? And we need to find ways to, like, foster that. And I think for me, the way in which we foster that curiosity is by sort of connecting these people and then seeing what happens, because it's different in the different regions, depending on who it is that's engaging, who it is that's working together, like something new happens.
Well, and I would say, you know, in my role, I've only been the director of the center for 9 months, so it's still very new for me, and I'm throwing a lot of spaghetti against the wall to see what sticks. But one of the big things that I have enjoyed the most, especially with my connection with the Arizona Presenters Alliance, is reaching out to my counterparts throughout the region in the presenting field. You know, my colleagues at Mesa Arts Center, at the Chandler Center, at Quickenburg, at the University of UA Presents in Tucson, and talking about how we can work together with artists that are emerging artists, whether they're local or regional, and really working as a team amongst all of us as presenters to nurture that artist and develop them within our market. Musical Instrument Museum is another great example, although their artistic director doesn't live here, so you kind of got to catch them as he's running past you. But we kind of have started with the MIM and their small theater, and we're talking about artists that we're all interested, that we're all excited about, that we've all taken notice of, and talking about making a several year long plan with this artist where we all come together in a collaboration to co-present them in all of our venues over the course of several years. And all of these engagements with the artists would include education, so that at the same time we're not competing for artists and competing against each other and getting pissed at each other and spending more money than we should on our competitions, but we're also working together to identify artists, because I'm a huge believer that 2, 3, 4, 5, 12 heads are better than one. I learn about new artists from my counterparts all the time. And so this is something we're still experimenting with. We have kind of our first experiment with a co-promotion between performing arts centers next season. So hopefully it goes beautifully. We can continue to move forward. But this is kind of our ultimate plan, to kind of work together as almost a cooperative to nurture artists, and maybe someday multiple artists at a time, to grow from a 300-seat venue to a 600-seat venue to an 800-seat venue up to a 1,500-seat venue, and then, you know, then maybe unleash into the promoters will let them to arenas and football fields and whatever else, you know, they do at that level, which is way beyond my head.
I'm going to echo what Daniel said earlier in the previous panel about this idea of social capital and how you use social capital to build and strengthen these relationships. I think the same principle works kind of in building relationships between artists and presenters and venues. That's sort of getting to know one another. I think I'm going to speak to how presenters sometimes approach audiences, and that there has been kind of the principle of sort of like, you know, Captain Kirk jumping down to the sky and saying, engage the audience development plan. I think that's happened all too often, where they start to sort of, you know, to exercise something where they really don't have the relationships. And spending time, presenters are now more and more invested. They have to be. Just looking around them, they have no alternative but then to reach out and start building relationships in the community. And if they're not, they're going to be left behind. The West is changing really, really quickly. We are all experiencing that. And the country's experiencing now. Look at our sort of political situation. And I think that so they have, you have something to offer, and they have something from that they need from you. So I think there's opportunities there to exchange social capital, build relationships, and really sort of define a path through those relationships, because it really starts fundamentally kind of with relationships, both between the presenter and the audience, and between the artist and the presenter.
That's a nice segue, relationships, to you guys. So it's the question, questions from any one of you. Stephanie, please.
The very last comment that you made, Tim, about the audience engagement, and the comment that I just made to my colleague Bonnie over here, just as you mentioned, we're like, these organizations have to. They're in a place now that they have to do that. And I said to her, accept that they want to do that on their terms is the challenge with that. Or on the backs of other people, instead of doing the work, we'll hire the person who has the relationship in the community and break them off a little bit of something. But we want it to fit in our box of doing things. So can you talk a little bit about any of the experience with that?
I agree. I've seen it too from our side. I mean, I think that's a variation on the whole thing, just sort of, you know, kind of phoning it in, kind of audience engagement. But I think it's changing. I think that, frankly, I think that grant makers like Mellon Foundation and others, and Irvine, and Paul Allen, well, less extent Paul Allen Foundation, but certainly Irvine, some of the grant makers are actually putting out carrots that are really kind of sort of fostering, I would hope, some substantive change in how we do this work. But I think it's absolutely the case that, that they want it on their terms, and I think that everybody just needs to be really clear with each other about expectations. And if you're not seeing your expectations sort of fulfilled, then I think these people are, they've landed in these positions. It's not by accident. They've sort of, they've grown up, they've sort of earned their way in, at least in their sort of own eyes. They've found their way in these positions. They're smart people, and they either adapt or they move away, or they're, you know, I mean, I think that there's, they're in a situation now where we're at a point of crisis. I think it has to start accelerating. And I think that, that artists need to start engaging. And if the processes are not satisfactory, then you need to be prepared and invested enough to be able to walk away, or at least to be able to first to say, this isn't working for me. And you know, it's really scary. It's really, really scary. I mean, this year at WAW, I mean, we turned over a day-long program that was very expensive to produce to really like 13 people, but we didn't really know that well. But it was a really important move for us to give that power to these 13 individuals who knew far more about this work than any of us. And so in hindsight, it was a risk worth taking by certain. And I think that's what we need to sort of let presenters know, that Rachel Maza and Sandra, I don't know if anybody knows Rachel Maza from Field Vigery, which is one of the leading Aboriginal companies in Australia. She talks about this idea of coming at this from a deficit. You know, like for Indigenous artists and Aboriginal artists, that we're coming at this, we're entering this field from a deficit position. That there's a deficit that needs to be made up for. When in fact, sort of advancing Indigenous artists and work in our networks and in our communities and our performing arts center enriches their work, enriches their community, and can fundamentally change the way that they do work. So it can inspire presenters to do work in new ways.
Clive? This question is for Gabriela about the Arizona Commission of the Arts. Are you a public agency?
Yeah, we're a state agency.
State agency, and how large is your budget?
I joined the commission about 3 months ago, so I know my own budget, but I will actually be attending our very first board meeting on Thursday, so we are overseen by a board of commissioners that are appointed by the governor, so that should give you a sense.
I think we're number 49 out of 50 in terms of what the Arts Council receives from the state.
And then lastly, what are the advocacy efforts, if any, underway, grassroots to empower or strengthen your particular agency?
Yeah, well, we have an organization. They're called Arizona Citizens for the Arts. They actually are housed right across from us. I would say that we are desperate for your advocacy. It's really sort of, we're in a moment of real need where we really kind of need you all to advocate. And we actually, so we utilize your success stories, right? We actually utilize those to really highlight the ways in which the art that is being produced is transforming communities. And it is sort of, in many ways, what allows us to continue doing some of the work. But we do need your advocacy. I mean, I would say even at the very like local level, right?
So just to follow up on that and to build on an idea that Roberto put out there in terms of the connection of ideas, right? So I'm in Texas, I've been there 2 years, and we have an advocacy organization. We go to the state on an annual basis, and specifically I'm in Dallas, and we also have a local advocacy group. We've been able to use language that's friendly to the state legislature to, you know, cross both aisles to preserve our commission's resources and find other avenues to increase those resources, specifically through the designation of more arts districts, right, across the state. And locally in Dallas over the last couple of years, you know, so when I arrived, there was zero resources for individual artists out of the Office of Cultural Affairs. In 2 years, that budget has increased to $500,000. And the local OCA just announced a cultural equity initiative to fund under-resourced communities in Dallas. And when I arrived, those conversations were already happening, but they're also accelerating across multiple sectors of disciplines, both on grassroots level, across theater companies, individual artists, major institutions, even human rights groups. So it's like a really interesting, so I just want to put that out there, you know, because I don't think Texas and Arizona are that different.
Just having been here for 12 years and having been through a lot of the arts conversations with our local commission, we do a similar thing with Arizona Commission of the Arts. They do an annual advocacy day where the entire day is focused on the arts. They bring in arts leaders and arts professionals from around the state, and they will specifically, I guess Arizona Citizens for the Arts does a lot of the coordinating, where we specifically set up face-to-face meetings with our legislators, both the representatives and the state senators, to talk to them about the importance of the arts. And you know, sometimes those meetings go sideways because those politicians have decided they don't care about arts funding and they just want a free lunch, that's all. But at the same, I just wanted to also throw out, for anybody who's not from Arizona, the state of Arizona's arts funding has a really gross history over the past 5 years, five or ten years maybe, of the decline in the arts funding. I think that the current general appropriation from the state budget to the Arts Commission is $800,000. And every year we advocate for a one-time $1 million for grant programs. This year we didn't get it, last year we got it, next year we don't know. So there's a lot of that back and forth as far as the public funding through the commission. And then additionally, I think, I want to say it was 6 years ago, our state legislators made a decision to sweep a quasi-endowment that had been set up for the Arizona Commission that had $23 million in it. And they took all of it. So the state funding issue in Arizona as far as public funding, I know Patricia Fires a lot of you are from Arizona, you know all this, but for anybody who is not here, that's kind of the state of what we're facing as far as public funding for the state agency.
I don't have the exact numbers, but this is from my survey that I mentioned a few minutes ago. The average for Western states, state funding for Western states is 42 cents per capita in the Western states. And the average grant in the Western states is $6,500. The next closest is South Arts, which serves the Southern states, which is 76 cents per capita, and about an average grant of about $12,000. Then go NEFA in New England. This is 2012 data, $3.20 per capita, and an average grant of about $12,000 from the states in the New England area.
So, thank you for mentioning NEFA, and I actually would applaud you guys for the fact that you take on a national charge, because we're so anemic. Even though going back to the West Coast, East Coast, I feel like I'm talking to you, Kathy. I love you. But the fact that a regional service organization has taken it under their mission to actually move beyond their geographic call to do a discipline call that allows us to actually have access to that. But I think this discussion about public funding and private funding, and I just need to underscore that Arizona is very poor, philanthropic, both public and private. The Arts Council has lost close to 60% of their budget since the recession.
So it's small monies, it's trafficking in small monies, again. But I want to kind of move over here because I like moving over here. And I like how advances happen in the field, and I want you guys to talk about this as funders and presenters. How you pay attention to what's happening over here. And I truly believe that advances happen obliquely. So what does your antenna say about that? How does your antenna work?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I think, I'm trained as an artist. I'm posing as an arts administrator. I've engaged with Xico. Christina's like, tell them one of your prints is hanging here. And that's how I stay connected, right? That's how I listen. Like, I listen to my colleagues. I listen to, you know, I show up, right? So I think that's really important to show up for one another. And I think, like, Tucson's particularly strong about that. I think that's why the work that you will do is really, really strong. And we see it here in Phoenix and in different pockets, and maybe it's because we're so spread out, but showing up for one another, listening to the work that's being produced, asking one another, right? Like, I'll ask Martin, you know, who gave me like my first paid job. I'll be like, hey, like, what are you working on? Or what are you, you know, breaking bread with someone and asking them about what is the work that they're excited about, right? That somebody else is making. Because as artists, like, we're always talking with one another. We're always talking about our work. We're workshopping, you know, our work. Like, it's important to stay involved in the community through which we move and in which we work.
Well, I was just going to say something quite similar to that. You know, I grew up in a performing arts family. Performing arts has been my life, my whole life. So, you know, from the moment I moved here, I went out into the community and saw work at all different theaters and lots of clubs. And now that I'm in this role that I'm in, obviously my time is not as free as it was back then, sadly. But I have engaged a programming team, where we've really changed our model at the Center about programming. It's not really just one person curating the entire series any longer. It's really a team of six people who work together with their teams as well. So we sit down on a monthly basis and go over a calendar of the entire region and everything that's happening. What is this festival happening in Mesa? What is this performing art piece that's coming out at the Monterey Gallery? What's going on? What's Rachel Bodish's latest thing? We love her work. And we kind of sit down and we assign to each other, you're going to go see this, you're going to go see that, you're going to go see the other, so that then we can report back to each other on what's going on in the community. I'm also extremely lucky to have a programming manager who is a visual artist and is very well connected throughout the Phoenix Grand Avenue line of visual artists, and she's constantly coming to me and telling me about her new studio mate or the things that are happening First Fridays up and down Grand Avenue, and so that's kind of, I feel like that might be a lame answer, but that's really how we stay connected at the center. And then, of course, the conversations that I was talking about earlier with my counterparts of the Arizona Presenters Alliance, I learned a tremendous amount from them and what they're seeing and thinking about and getting excited about. But certainly throughout the community, from day one, I've been astonished. Like, as I mentioned, I was recruited and moved to Scottsdale from New York for this job, so I knew nothing about Arizona when I came here. I didn't even have a car, which in Arizona, as you know, is like shining light. And I was completely blown away by the quality of the performing arts work that was happening here that I had no idea about. Even having toured across the country and being through Arizona on tour, I had no idea, and it was incredibly, it still impresses me, and at the same time infuriates me that the whole country doesn't look at Phoenix and say, that's the most amazing work is coming out of Phoenix. So that's, now that I have this position, I'm hoping to help change that, but it's not just one person, it's a lot of us.
In the planning of the conference, we get a much better conference as a result of it. In Vancouver, because we've never met in Vancouver, we're almost 50 years old, we've had Canadian members in our organization for more than 30 years, but we've never met in Canada. And so we had to engage people beyond our own membership in planning the Vancouver conference. And we had a much better conference. So getting out of our own circle, and so now we have a group, a similar group in Los Angeles. It's not just members. We're reaching out to people, stakeholders, like ACTA and others in the community, to help create the conference program in Los Angeles. ACTA is the association, or the Alliance of California Traditional Artists. So we're reaching beyond our own circle to create a conference plan. And again, it seems kind of self-evident, but it really, it's made all the difference for our work.
I have a question. I'm thinking about the conversation we were having just a little while ago around funding and that statistic around the West. And it surprises me, but then I think about it, and it's like, oh, it doesn't. But I actually wonder if, you know, we're having this conversation, and I think about local context, and here, like, the whole point of this convening is to think about, like, how work happens locally, and just to filter in. And I think about the West, and I think about, it's libertarian. I mean, it just is. And so, of course, we're not going to have that kind of government funding, because that's just not the context that we live in. It's not. And so to try to compare state funding is like trying to say, well, New England has no cactuses. Like, how many cactuses do you have? And they don't. You know, it's like trying to make New England something that it's not. But then the question comes up to me, kind of that comes into my brain, is given the local context, given the regional context, the work gets done, but we're trying to look at it through this realm that, okay, it feels like we're trying to apply this prism that doesn't really work. And of course we're going to fall short of it because it's not what we do, it's not who we are, it's not. But what I don't know is what is it? If it's not that, and compare ourselves to that, doesn't seem helpful. What is the local prism? What is the local context? What is the local practice?
I don't think we can make ourselves New England out here in the West. I'm not saying that. But I think that grant makers, funding agencies, the National Endowment certainly is looking at these things, and they're looking at data in the aggregate, they're looking at impact, they're looking at results, and there simply isn't the volume. I mean, I think it's more about a reality check. There isn't nearly the volume of producing activity or presenting activity in the West as we see in other parts of the country. It just, I mean, not only in funding, but if you look at the infrastructure of presenting organizations, it's first of all, in the New England, it's a concentrated population area, population center. So that's an exception. But even in the Midwest, on a density basis, there's far more activity, grant activity in each congressional district than there is in the West. So it's understanding that, I think, is important, that we understand where we fit. And so then that gives us direction about how to produce, how to present, how to make work. I think it's really just understanding sort of the infrastructure that we're swimming in different pools.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. We're totally doing that. And within that, how do we start to better explain the pool that we've built? Like, I feel like that's where we're failing, is that we haven't been able to actually say, it looks like this. And think about, like, we're eventually talking about, like, park life. Like, here, like, people go to parks, and arts happen in a park, and they're not presented. They emerge. But it's
just as enriching and as valuable as what's happening at the Scottsdale Center. Or, yeah.
Right. Exactly.
So does that mean that the parks budget needs to increase?
Yes!
So my thing is, you know, despite, I agree with you, yes, there are libertarian values across this particular region, but that doesn't, those values don't come into play when a for-profit entity needs tax subsidies to facilitate the development of a new commercial real estate property, right?
Right,
and if we're talking about economic development, and we're talking about creative communities that give life to this. I'm not letting public officials off the hook.
Right.
You know, when it comes to supporting arts and culture.
Right.
Uh, you, Clyde, you opened such a door. Yes. Especially with public, because we've talked about a lot about it. I think that my colleagues and Yvonne and Maribel would understand that we're under the pressure in Tucson of what our municipal our leadership, they want bankable culture. They want something that generates sales dollars and that fills the city coffers. They don't really care about new work. They don't really care that much about the individual artists.
I don't
artists.
Really think they care about that work either, because I did that work and they don't really care about me.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's lip service. I mean, they have other, whatever they care about, it's a different concern. I mean, so I wouldn't say that, like, I wouldn't steer everybody off like into this other direction of feeling like you should, you know, be this, like, you know, economic engine for the city, because we already are an economic engine for the city, and all I get is lip service.
Right, right, right. But so I'm getting, when I was getting lip service, I want like a dozen festivals and whatever, whatever. We all have our headaches, really significant headaches. But this idea of sort of kind of the DIY spirit of presenting and self-producing, that is, you know, kind of in the landscape. It goes back to the metaphor of the scarcity and how much abundance. Daniel.
Well, Mark and Clyde, you've cracked open Pandora's box, and I'm just gonna rip the lid off. I mean, really, so far, when we talk about these arts institutions, simply by saying institution, we're talking about a structure of organization that has is pretty ethno-specific and has been inherited from the East and further East across the pond. And those structures don't really work in an environment where there are other cultures that are in the majority, because you're imposing a structure on something that already has a structure. And so there's this disconnect. And so like Jane and I were talking earlier about, since we're on live casting, I won't name names, but we were talking about organizations in my home city, current home city, that really function the same way that they would in New York, or function the same way that they would in Berlin.
They do.
And so I think really what I'm interested in is how do we create new structures of organizing people and creativity in a way that is more harmonious with, going back to my co-panelist's notion of the landscape, right, that actually uses images from the landscape here and the culture sphere, which are rooted to the landscape. You know, I was recently invited to be part of a conversation with one of those big organizations in my home city, and they were mourning the fact that they had been trying to get certain people to the table for a long time, and that those people weren't at the table. Well, it was great that they were asking who's not at the table, because that's actually the first step, because a lot of people don't even ask that question. But the answer to me seems fairly simple. Move the table. The people that they wanted to have at the table were miles away, could not take a lunch to drive half an hour to be someplace for an hour meeting and then drive back and lose 2 hours of work. I mean, you move the table. You change the structure of the organization. You relocate. You swap. I actually suggested that the chair of the board was in the room. I said, I know it's going to drive you crazy, but what would happen if you actually moved your operations to one of the warehouses in the south side and gave the artist in the south side run of this building for 6 months or a year? I mean, if we're talking about, because Tim, you quoted me before about social capital, but it has to be an exchange. It's, you can't use someone's social capital. You actually have to come with something that people want. So, I don't know, let's use the rest of the time to talk, reinvent the notion of the institution and what does that look like, and where do we even start? But that's clearly what has to happen, because everybody's acknowledged that audiences are changing, demographics are changing. You know, I mentioned before that theater with a capital T does not reach some cultural groups, because it seems to not be part of that culture, but of course performance is. But going up to the balcony and sitting in the last row of seats, it's not. So
that's
a comment and then a question for the guys. Perfect. Here's.
No, I got it.
Who's next? You got next? You got next?
In this advocacy world in Arizona, there was an effort about 3-4 years ago to create a taxing initiative led by two significant funders in Phoenix who only funded Maricopa County. So they did a study of Latino audiences. And when they found out from the study of the audiences that the Latino community self-described their number one cultural activity as going to the park. Wasn't going to the theater, wasn't going to the concert, it was going to the park. So then the next day I get a report from somebody that says, there's no Latinos in my theater. And I'm saying, well, you're not looking at where they're sitting. You know what I mean? Come on, you're supposed to do cross-reference in your homework. But in some ways, this notion of what Daniel is trying to say, that there is this moment of reimagining what we need to envision the role of this producer moment in time. So I'll just guest prompt to all of you guys. Who's got the vision?
This isn't really on the vision, it's another question, but I have been thinking a lot about who sets the terms for building a career, a life in art that's successful. And I think there's an old model that's still on the table, and actually I was curious to hear Ali talk about it a little bit, because at its best, I hope there's going to be life in all models. But you know, this idea that presenters could help build a career for artists. I mean, certainly when I came into the field, that was a major operating assumption, that presenters would get together, decide, you know, who showed a lot of promise, who they were interested in, commission them, move them around their venues. And a lot of our operating systems as funders are also kind of predicated on that model. And as a former presenter, I've been part of initiatives like that I think have been successful. But Roberto's talking about what we kind of sort of see over here. And one of the things that I do feel we've been seeing a lot of is that artists are really starting to build their own economic model when it comes to working with communities and working with presenters. And I'm not sure whether that's because presenters, you know, are under some infrastructure attrition themselves and just can't invest in commissioning and research and resourcing artists as well as they used to, or whether it's a legitimate kind of re-understanding of the artists in the ecosystem and the fact that they, artists have real visions for where they want to go and be and the audiences and the communities they want to engage with that don't always align with presenters and the way we work. And even Tim, you made an interesting comment. You said, I guess relationships are so important, which they are, but artists and presenters need to have relationships and presenters have relationships with audiences. But I am thinking about that third part of the triangle, which is that artists often know who they want their audiences to be. And I think you were getting a little bit at that too, that when a, you know, presenter kind of tries to outsource that pure and simple to artists, it really doesn't work. But at NEFA with the National Theater Project, we're thinking structurally about how to, you know, really incentivize the development of sustainable ways of working and engagement with audiences for artists. And sometimes I think that happens with presenters as a critical linchpin, and other times I'm not as sure anymore. So it's, I guess it's a question.
But there are several things come to mind. I think that presenters are more and more relying on the They're looking for artists that have established relationships with audiences. And so social media is playing a bigger and bigger factor. Artists that have established relationship with, you know, through social media, then that really becomes an asset of the artist to the presenter. So that's something that I think is changing. And I think in terms of your earlier kind of dichotomy of, you know, which is it, I think it's both. I think that that the both of those kind of factors are in play, and I think that more and more of the venues that most of our members own and operate are kind of like the albatross. You know, it's their assets and their obstacles. They're obstacles for entry. They're obstacles for budgets, for maintenance. They're weighing them down, so they simply don't have the capacity that they did once, you know, 20, you know, 30 years ago. And so that you know, building an infrastructure and obligations. I mean, Ali was talking about. I mean, I think it's. I'm sure it's true at ASU. And again, that just, you know, all the responsibilities. Presenters are not simply programmers. You know, they run facilities. They have obligations to the faculty and students. You know, they have public events that they're doing. There's all these different demands that sort of pull away from what was, I think, at one time, the core mission as a presenting organization and as a way of building relationship between the institution of higher learning and a community around them. And that is more and more difficult in this day and age of economics and accountability and obligations for the university, you know, to fulfill, to do more with less. Well, that was a satisfying answer.
I mean, I think that also we see, you know, like Rising Youth Theater, for example, who's operating out of New Box, so they're in residence there. But then they did this like incredible performance along the light rail in Phoenix, like all over. So I think when those relationships, right, which sort of goes back, I think, to another question of like, how do we make sure that all parties are being treated with equal respect and agency? I think when artists don't find that, then they balk the whole system. And they, you know, they do it their own way, like on their own kind of DIY, right? If that structure isn't there that will support them and treat them with respect, that they will simply like go their way. I mean, how does All Souls Possession like do it? Right?
All Souls is another kind of thing.
So
I can say that I did APAP and WAV for 10 years, spent $75,000 of my own money in 10 years, and never got one single gig from any of them. But yet I can get booked for in a foreign country in a heartbeat by a city government or a developer that sees the value in what I do. When I turn in paperwork that says the event makes $30 million a year for the city, people in the city don't get it, but other people do. But yeah, I stopped. I gave up on presenters last year. We stopped doing all the conferences. I said no more money to the presenters and their organizations. And I feel so much better about it. I feel like I'm back in my game now. I don't have to deal with like all the stuff, going to water, going to AFAP, buying a booth, doing all the games, doing the showcase, paying for the showcase. Oh, didn't get a single gig. And it's happened for 10 years. I gave it 10 years of presenter land. And I'm so much happier now, I have to say. Because, yeah, you kind of said it, the like presenter breed is changing and dying out, and the new school is coming in. And hopefully, the institutions that hold the purse strings will allow people to give their audiences a little more credit. Not everyone wants to see the Electric Light Orchestra version of Hunchback of Notre Dame. Like, it's really, I know it's sold like in Detroit or it's sold in Chicago, but it is such a horrible thing. It's not art. It is simply a commodity-based product, not based in the creative like movement. There's something vital going on that presenters and most city people don't see. They don't see what people are really wanting. At least with All Souls, there's 150,000 people and more are going to come out this year. And I have nothing to do with it. All I do is hold on to the reins and buy insurance and porta potties. Okay, everybody good. Right? So it's a strange thing to be in the conversation now, and it's like, I don't know, I just don't, there's a lot more work that has to get done on, if there's a side, on the presenter's civic body side. The artists are doing the work and we always continue to do the work, you know? I mean, I spend 200 hours a year writing $40,000 worth of grants. I do pretty good for Tucson, for Arizona. I feel like I'm on the top tier. I feel like, wow, I'm up there. So I don't know, I don't know. It's a really good conversation.
I wanted to just speak on, I think what you're touching on is, or made me think about, is like knowing what our strengths are, whether we're a presenter or an artist. And for Junebug, we happen to be both a presenter and the artist, and really interested in, I think it was you, Tim, who were saying, talking about people who are playing all these multiple roles within companies. And, you know, I think we've only been able to present artists for over 30 years without a venue, without our own space, because of really strong partnerships. One being one with the Contemporary Arts Center. And, you know, in order to have those strong relationships, we really need to know what our strength is and the audience that we bring. So, you know, we bring something to the table that maybe the CAC didn't bring to the table, but we each bring our own strengths, and that's the only way we're able to really survive. So, you know, we bring an African-American audience that is really important to the CAC, for example. And the CAC brings resources that we don't have, and it's the only way we've been able to survive. And, you know, another thing I just wanted to talk about, this is not as exciting, but with the state funding, I feel like it just needs to be said, and I know this is probably, you know, talked about a lot, but these grant applications, I mean, I just feel like these state agencies are kind of shooting themselves in the foot a little bit at times, because like you said, you need those strong artists and that helps the agency, but when you make the process so difficult, I mean, a lot of people just decide it's not worth the process. And I'm not saying they're all like that, but there's got to be a way to like make some of this universal, like even if it was just following the NEA budget, if we could just have that budget form for all of them, then that would even make it a little bit easier. But you know, for $1,000, $2,000, like we just don't apply anymore. It's not worth it to us. The amount of time it takes to do that is like, yeah, could cost that much, you know, to do the application and final report. So, I feel like sometimes I want to be like, Louisiana Arts, we just need to boycott this process so that we can change this whole system, because as grateful as we are for funding, it's just, it's huge. It's taxing on a small organization with limited capacity.
Hi, I'm Michael Reed from AAC Gamage. Colleen was here earlier, correct, our executive director. I just wanted to touch base a little bit on what I heard Tim talking about and Kathy touching on in regard to what is the evolving identity of college and university presenters. And you're right, Tim, there's many, many things that are asked of us of the university now that have nothing to do presenting the arts. But I also, I've been doing work there for 20 years and work with community for 20 years and in every kind of capacity you could think of as community members on stage at Gamage and professional productions and productions produced all around the valley, the Gila River Reservation and other places. And one of the things that in working with Aaron Landsman, who was here earlier, he's been with us about 4 years, it became clear several years ago is know that you don't know. So if you're starting to work with a community you haven't worked with before, as a presenter who's part of a big organization, go ask all the questions, go find out as much as you can, go find out what it is that would serve a particular organization's mission you're talking with. This week we had Marta Gonzalez here from Quetzal, the music group in LA. And I think we're gonna work together next year as far as our Gamage residency artist. And we had 2 days of full meetings with pretty much mostly community organizations and ASU people who were also had several identities as far as community artists and ASU professors. And I learned more in those two days, Tuesday and Wednesday, about several different community organizations I knew in the Valley for 20 years than I had known in 20 years. So that just reiterated for me that there is a place for university presenters or college presenters or presenters to do this work really well with artists, but really it was Martha driving the meetings. Who do you want to meet with? Here are some people I think might be good to meet with. What do you think? Who do you want to meet with? And then we've also changed our model a lot over the years in that we present less artists now than we did 20 years ago or 15 years ago. But we have much closer, deeper connections with different community organizations and even the ASU community, which is a small city. There's 85,000 students now. So that's much more impactful. If we do less artists, we bring less artists, but they're helping and most of the time driving what's going to happen in regard to interaction off campus and on campus much of the time. And I try and step out of the way. And I try and take those resources we would use to have three or four or five other artists come in the season, on our seasons, and put them towards supporting that work, that infrastructure work, for doing work in community, whether it's going to be community performances and formal performance, or whatever it may turn out to be, what's driven by the artists working with us together.
This will be the last question because we're going to have a show. Go ahead.
Okay. So going back to the artist presenter, I'm at CAC where I got to work with Juba for a soundtrack. And my question is when does everyone just apologize for what they don't know? The reason we are tight, the reason we're together, the reason we can go to stuff together and even share rooms at times is because what I didn't know, I asked. But I think that it's very difficult sometimes for an artist to understand that when they're dealing with a presenter, they could be dealing with 35 other people who didn't spend 2 years developing the work with them. So the head of marketing thinks, it's about black people, but I'm not black. And I don't go to church, so I guess I'll just dole it out, right? And so it's hard for the presenter who's sent to the artist to keep the same relationship. So how do we develop a better sense of understanding not just the ecosystem, but that like the one person who loves your work that's in the organization isn't necessarily the usher or the ED or the head of marketing, or diva, right? It's the curator or that presenter or program director. That's my question. How do we galvanize our organizations to actually understand what our mission is?
That's a great last question.
That's a great question. Now, I would say the best thing is. I would say the best thing is that the more I want to say some of the most successful engagements that we have had with artists that we know most of our staff just doesn't get, and they're not cluing into what the real work is about. is when the artist is able to take time to come and meet with all of us as a group, because we all meet as a group already, and so we talk through every programming decision and why we want to book this artist and why we're in love with this project, so that everybody kind of gets that sense from the beginning of, this is why I'm telling you guys we're going to do this artist. It's not just passed down from on high. But we have those face-to-face meetings with the artists whenever we can, but when it's not possible, if the artist is from out of town or if they're just too busy, we also work to kind of put together almost an EPK for internal use, where we can kind of pass this around so that the marketing team can all look at this document to glean what they need from it, our development team can glean what they need from it, Even our front of house manager can make sure that, you know, the ushers and house manager know what to talk about or how to respond to questions that they get questions from our patrons about, you know, this email tomorrow night, what's really going on. So it's labor intensive to do that, and it takes time, but I've found that it's been really helpful for us this year to get that communication flowing, and it's a process, it's not been perfect, but we're starting and we're taking baby steps and we're pushing to expand that as much as we can. I don't know if that's directly answering your question, because there's not, I wish I could give you more information for like how the artists can really be involved in that. But I mean, frankly, from my perspective, the more information I can get from the artists as far as samples of the work or background about the artist or background about how the piece came to be, or even coming in advance and having that meeting with the staff, or even coming in advance and doing a special presentation for the audience. We do that a lot of lectures in advance of the show, whether it's with the artist or if it's with a local expert on the subject matter. That's been really beneficial for us as well. Is that helpful?
Tim, you have a
question. I do, actually. I think it's a really good question. And I think that organizations need to sort of just take those baby steps and to try new things and to fail at it. They need to start engaging and answering and confessing that they don't know when they don't. I think that presenting at its worst is a really transactional business. You know, it is a transaction. It's a series of transactions. And we need, going back to Daniel's demand that we envision some new ways of working, I think the further we can get away from presenting as a transactional kind of event, the healthier it is going to be for everyone. I think that's really what, sort of the nature of the work.
On that note, let's thank our panelists for taking a break. In a few minutes, we'll be gathered to see Judy Columbus. Thank you.
May I add to that? Folks, can I request that all of us fold our chairs and actually take